إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد بن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start the sharah, the explanation of ilmu tafsir min al-Nuqayah. And what I'm going to do first is, as a madkhal, as an introduction, I'm going to be speaking about at-ta'rifu bil-musannif. Who is the author of this book? And then I'm going to go into at-ta'rifu bil-musannaf. And then I'm going to talk about the book, inshallah ta'ala. So first I'm going to talk about the author, and then I'm going to talk about the book, inshallah ta'ala. The author of this book is Jalaluddin AbdulRahman ibn Abi Bakr ibn Muhammad ibn Sabiq al-Din al-Khudayri al-Suyuti. He's known as Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, in simple. Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, rahimahullah. The Shaykh, rahimahullah, he was born the year 849 Hijriah, and he died the year 911 Hijriah. So he will be how old? 62, right? He will be 62, correct? 62 years of age, right? That's how old he was when he died, rahimahullah. Scholars who've written about his biography, they said he has more than 1,000 books. 1,000 books. Just over 1,000 books. Some of them are volumes, and some of them are just awraq, a couple of pages. Okay? Suyuti doesn't need anyone to talk about his biography. The reason is because he wrote two books in talking about himself. He has a kitab called Husnul Muhadara fi tarikh Misr wal Qahira, where he talked about himself. And he also wrote another book talking about himself, and he called it At-Tahadduthu bi-Ni'matillahi. At-Tahadduthu bi-Ni'matillahi, speaking about the blessing of Allah on you. He wrote those two books, and he talked about himself. And he says the following, so we'll just read from what he said about himself. He says in his book, Husnul Muhadara, he said, وَشَرَعْتُ فِي التَّصْنِيفِ, I started to author. في سنة ستين وستين, when the year was 66, referring to 866. وبلغت مؤلفاتي إلى الآن 300 كتب, and as till now I have 300 books, he said. سوى ما غسلته ورجعت منه, excluding the books I washed, I got rid of, and I came back from. The ones that I've allowed to be published, the ones that are out there and I agreed for its publication is 300 so far, he said. Okay? He said, وَسَافَرْتُ بِحَمْدِ اللَّهِ, based on the blessing of Allah, I have traveled, he said, إِلَى بِلَادِ الشَّامِ, I traveled to Sham, وَالْحِجَازِ, وَالْيَمَنِ, وَالْهِنْدِ, وَالْمَغْرِبِ, I traveled to all of those places. He said, "Walamma hajjajtu," when I went to do hajj, he said, "Sharibtu ma'a zamzam," I drank the zamzam water. Li'umurin, for many reasons. Many reasons is why I drank the zamzam water. The first he mentioned is, an asila fil fiqh, I want to reach fiqh ila martabati shaykh Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. I want to reach the level of Sirajuddin al-Bulqini in fiqh. I want to read his... Are you there, brothers? The reason why I drank the zamzam water was, I want to reach the level of fiqh Sirajuddin al-Bulqini reached. وَفِي الْحَدِيثِ and in hadith, I want to reach إِلَى مَرْتَبَةِ ibn Hajar, the level of Hafiz ibn Hajar. That was the reason why I drank that zamzam water, he said. وَأَفْتَيْتُ, I gave fatwa. سَنَةَ إِحْدَى وَسَبْعِينَ, when the year was 71. وَعَقَدْتُ Imla al hadithi, I sat down to dictate hadiths. Sanatathnataini was sab'ina, 1 year later, 72. I was dictating hadiths. He then said, Waruziqtu, Allah gave me, provided for me, at tabahur. I'm an ocean, he said, in seven sciences, ocean. At tafsīr, wal hadith, wal fiqh, wal nahw, wal ma'ani, wal bayan, wal badi'. عَلَىٰ طَرِيقَةِ الْعَرَبِ وَالْبُلَغَىٰ I reached, he said. I'm an imam in tafsir. I'm an imam, tabahur, in al-hadith, in al-fiqh, in nahu, in ma'ani, in bayan, also in al-ma'ani, and in bayan, and in al-badi'. The three types of balagha, al-ma'ani, al-bayan, and al-badi'. In what way, lakin? عَلَىٰ طَرِيقَةِ الْعَرَبِ وَالْبُلَغَىٰ The level I am at in the Arabic language and I am in Balagha is reached the level of the Arabs. The Arab al-Aqha. He's an Arab himself, but he's talking about the Arabs whose language hasn't tainted. La ala tariqati al-ajam. I'm not like the foreigners who's become, ignorant of the Arabic language. I'm not like that, he said. Wa ahlu falsafa. Walladhi a'taqiduhu. He said, look at this. He said, walladhi a'taqidu, that which I believe. أَنَّ الَّذِي وَصَلْتُ إِلَيْهِ I believe that which I have reached مِنْ هَذِهِ الْعُلُومِ السَّبْعَ those seven sciences what I have reached regarding it سِوَى الْفِقْ other than fiqh وَالنُّقُولُ الَّتِي طَلَعْتُ عَلَيْهَا فِيهَا and also the quotes and the references that I have stood over لَمْ يَصِلْ إِلَيْهِ وَلَا وَقَفَ عَلَيْهِ no one has reached it and no one has come to that level مِنْ مَشَايِخِ from my teachers I have surpassed my teachers Only what science has he given an exception? Fiqh. He gave an exception to al-fiqh. He said, فَضْلًا عَمَّنْ دُونَهُمْ Let alone, forget, I've passed my teachers. Let alone those who are lower than my teachers. وَأَمَّا الْفِقْ فَلَا أَقُولُ ذَلِكَ فِيهِ I won't claim that in fiqh. I won't. بَلْ شَيْخِي فِيهِ أَوْسَعُ نَظَرًا My teacher has a more vast what? He has more vast knowledge than me. وَأَطْوَلُ بَاعًا And he's reached a higher level than me. And he's talking about Zakariya al-Ansari. And then he went on to saying, وَقَدْ كَمُلَتْ عِنْدِي Allah has completed with me الآن and now that I'm speaking, I'm writing this, آلَاتُ الْإِجْتِهَادِ I'm a mujtahid mutlaq. بِحَمْدِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى Based on the praise of Allah Ta'ala. أقول ذلك and I say this تحدثا بنعمة الله I'm only saying this out of speaking about the blessings Allah gave me سبحانه وتعالى لا فخرا I'm not saying to boast and brag that's not what I am doing it this statement caused Jalaluddin an uproar when he claimed ijtihad they got angry with him because the people of his time they believed The door of ijtihad is closed. They believed it was closed, it's over. What are you talking about? There is no ijtihad. The chapter of ijtihad is blocked. It is locked. There is no ijtihad. What are you talking about? Are we all together, brothers? And so he said, I will debate anyone in this issue. Jalaluddin Suyuti said this. I will debate anyone in the issue of ijtihad. Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense here? And he said, I will only debate a person of knowledge. And he said, a blind follower by the consensus of the scholar, he's not considered min hiyazi ahli al-ilm. He's not considered from the realm of people of knowledge. Ibn Abdul Barr transmitted that ijma' and Ibn al-Qayyim before him. A muqallid la yu'addu min jumlati ahli al-ilm. Bi-ijma' Ibn Abdul Barr mentioned that in his kitab Jami' Bayan al-Ilm al-Fadli. Before him, Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in his Nuniyah that the muqallid, the blind follower, he's not considered from the people of knowledge. So I will only debate a person who's not a blind follower. In other words, a person who's a mujtahid. That's the only person I will debate in this issue. Are we all together, brothers? That's the only person I would debate. And then he said, but when he comes to me as a mujtahid, he's already accepted that there is ijtihad, so the debate is over. Do you get the point? Jalaluddin al-Suyuti said that ijtihad is open. And they said to him, no, it's not open. Ijtihad is over. It's closed. No one is a mujtahid. And he said, there is ijtihad. And then when they gave him a hard time, he said, okay, I will debate on this issue. But remember, I won't debate a blind follower, because a blind follower is not considered from the people of knowledge by the consensus of the scholars. There's no difference of opinion. A muqallid is not considered a person of knowledge. And so I'm not going to sit with an ignorant person. I'm only going to sit with somebody of knowledge. And so if he is not a muqallid, that person has to be a what? A mujtahid, a person of knowledge. To be a person of ilm. Okay? And he said, if he isn't a muqallid, he's a mujtahid. And if he's a mujtahid, then the debate is over before it even starts. Because he's accepted, when he comes forward, that he himself is a mujtahid. And so this debate doesn't need to proceed. Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, his life and who he was, it's, rahimahullah, long and lengthy. But what I can say was, he's written many great books. Many great books. Each of his books, they can be spoken about in great details. Like, and I don't believe personally, he has written a book greater and better than his kitab al-Itqan fi ulum al-Qur'an. This book, there's no book like it. This book, al-Itqan fi ulum al-Qur'an, a student of knowledge has to try to finish it once a month in the course of his life, every month, at least read it. Al-Itqan fi ulum al-Qur'an. That book is one of the best books he has written, rahimahullah ta'ala. So, that's who Sara Ibulqi, Jalaluddin al-Suyuti is. And he's from Egypt, from a place called Usyut. Suyuti comes from a place called Usyut in Egypt, which till today is still called Usyut. And he died the year 911 Hijriya, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. Now let's go into the book. This book, what is this book? This book is called, and it's known as, إتمام الدراية لقراء النقاية. نقاية, I mean نقاية, both ways said. Okay. Which became very well known as Kitab al-Nuqāyah. The book al-Nuqāyah has 12 sciences in there. It's a big book. How many sciences does it have? It has 12 sciences in there. The author wrote that book, the Kitab al-Nuqāyah, when he was 22 years old. He only wrote it when he was what? When he was 22 years of age, Suyuti. I will mention at the end, inshallah. The Kitab al-Nuqāyah, he wrote it when he was 22 years of age. And in there he mentions Balagha, the three sciences, Al-Badi' al-Bayan al-Ma'ani, Bayan, Badi' al-Ma'ani, Nahu, Sarf, all of that he talks about there. And in one of the books that are in there is what? Ilmu? Ilmu al-Tafsir is one of those books in there. So we took that book out of the big book al-Nuqayah. The 12 sciences that are in there, we just took one science out. Are you with me, brothers? That's where it comes from, this book. But the author, rahimahullah, even though he wrote it when he was 22, he added two sciences in there after he reached age of 40. And those two sciences are ilmu al-tib and ilmu al-tashrih. He added those two sciences in there at the early stages of his life. Now let's go into what it means, ilmu al-tafsīr. That's what he chapter. He called it ilmu al-tafsīr. He called it. So we have to define ilm, and we have to define tafsīr. Ilm is naqidul jahli. It's the opposite of ignorance. And the technical definition of the word ilm is idraku shay'i ala ma huwa alayhi idrakan jazima. It is to perceive something as it is with certainty. That's what it means. It's perception of something as it is with certainty. Ibn Abdul Barr, rahimahullah, in his kitab Jam' Bayan al-Ilmi wa Fadli, he said, قال أهل العلم والنظر حد العلم التبيين وإدراك المعلوم على ما هو فيه فمن بان له الشيء فقد علمه قالوا والمقلد لا علم له ولم يختلفوا في ذلك. That the word ilm is when it means when something becomes clear to you. That's what knowledge is. And then he said after that, وَالْمُقَلِّدْ لَا عِلْمَ لَهُ. The blind follower, there's no knowledge with him. وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِفُ فِي ذَلِكَ. And the scholars did not differ on that. Because nothing has become clear to the blind follower. So we know, and we now understand what ilm means. What does the word ilm tafsir together, what does it mean? We know what ilm means. Now we want to go to the, sorry. We mentioned ilm, we haven't mentioned tafsir. Tafsir in the Arabic language, it means at-tawdih wal-bayan. The word tafsir in the Arabic language is at-tawdih wal-bayan. It's clarifying something. It's to clarify something. It's to make something apparent. And it's taken from ma'khudhun min al-fasri. It's taken from al-fasr. Al-fasr. That's what it's taken from. Which means al-kashfu wal-wuduh. It is to make something apparent and it's to make it clear. That's what it means. But the word tafsir, when the ulama of the sharia, the scholars of the sharia, when they say tafsir, what they mean by that is bayanu. It's to clarify, to make apparent. So see, the word clarifying is still in the technical meaning. But this time it's not clarifying anything other than the what? Other than the Qur'an. It is bayanu muradillahi azza wa jalla. It's to clarify the intent of Allah azza wa jalla. Min kalamihi, from his speech, al-munazzal, the speech of Allah that was sent down on ala Muhammadin, on Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bihasbi taqati al-bashariya, in accordance to the human ability. You're going to try to explain what Allah intended, okay, from his speech that he sent down on Muhammad, all in accordance to your ability and how much you're able to do it. That's what tafsir means. That's what tafsir means. But here, he said, ilmu tafsir. And he didn't say, at-tafsir. There's a problem here now. And that problem is, if we look at the muhtawayat al-kitab, what the book consists of, if we look at this book that he's got, we've got here, the Nuqayah, we find out that this book doesn't just deal with ilm al-tafsir, meaning the definition that we just gave, clarifying the meaning and the intent behind Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in his wordings that he has sent down on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in accordance to your ability. That's not what he did here. He brought other things which have nothing to do with tafsir, rather more general than tafsir. So what would have been better is is if he could have called it Ulumul Qur'an. The reason is because Ulumul Qur'an is a more general term than the word Ilmul Tafsir. Because Ilmul Tafsir falls under Ulumul Qur'an. And this book is more of Ulumul Qur'an than Ilmul Tafsir. Because in there he's going to mention other issues. He's going to mention other issues. So this book doesn't just talk about principles of how to do tafsir. No, it doesn't. That is called ilm al-tafsir. Or usul al-tafsir. Or qawa'id al-tafsir. Which all mean the same. Lakin ulum al-Qur'an is more comprehensive. It talks about how the Qur'an came down. What came down first? What was the last that came down? It also talks about when they came down. You see, which one of them was Makki? Which of them is Madani? وَمَا إِلَىٰ ذَٰلِكَ All of that is going to be mentioned, is going to be mentioned here by the author, rahimahullah. So this, to be very honest, should not be called ilm al-tafsir. It should be called what? It should be called ulum al-Qur'an, the science of the Qur'an. فَكَانَ الْأَلْيَقُ أَن يُسَمِّيَ هَذَا الْفَصْلَ بِعُلُومِ الْقُرْآنِ Because we're going to learn al-masail, comprehensive masail, that are connected to the Qur'an. When it came down, how the Qur'an was compiled. And it will also talk about how to do tafsir of the Qur'an and some issues related to that. Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense here?